Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Advocacy 101 webinar. I am here with Gina Kim from National Journal, as well as Jackie. We are going to be reviewing basically the basics that you need when you're here in DC in 2 weeks for the fly-in. If you have any questions, please use the chat feature. And I guess I will turn it over to Gina.
Thank you, Chelsea, and good afternoon to everyone, and welcome to our webinar on fly-in advocacy for ELFA advocates. My name is Gina Kim, Chief Analytics Officer at National Journal, and really excited to share with you this information to help you gear up for your upcoming meetings on Capitol Hill. I want to thank the Equipment Leasing and Finance Association for inviting us to come speak with you. And we have a fair amount of ground to cover, but we will pull up in certain spots to address any questions. And if you have questions, I think you can add them at any time. Okay, well, with that out of the way, let me kick us off by orienting everyone to the discussion. Okay, turning first to our roadmap, I'll begin with some context for your upcoming meetings, contextualizing fly-ins and your role in the I think we lost sound for a little bit. Just wondered if folks can hear me now. Perfect. Back here on the slide, we've got the basics of how federal advocacy works. On the left, of course, we've got Congress and the White House that create laws and regulations that govern citizens. And then on the right, we as citizens influence the governing bodies. So it's a mutually reinforcing mechanism, and of course, ELFA has a very robust advocacy program, really encouraging their members to make their voices heard by federal lawmakers. Now, what's key is that we demonstrate that there is citizen interest in the political landscape. And how do we do this? Well, if you look at that call-out box in the upper right-hand side, some of the ways that we demonstrate our interest are by showing support, asking for change, telling stories about our experience, describing how policy proposals impact our day-to-day. But we share ideas for how things could be improved, and we provide information. So taken all together, we not only make our views known, but we act as a resource for those in Washington. And at the bottom right, a quick description of fly-ins. It's just one way for constituent advocates to connect with lawmakers here in the nation's capital. Fly-ins have increased exponentially in the last decade, and members of Congress consistently say they want to hear from fly-in visitors. To reinforce that point, members of Congress do want to hear from you. Now, why is that? Well, on the left-hand side, it's your feedback that guides policymaking. You are the ones that are best positioned to educate lawmakers on how different legislative and regulatory proposals impact your industry or your community. And of course, our lawmakers want to be sure that their actions are consistent with voters' views. Now, we'll be communicating our views not only to members of Congress, but to their staff as well. And lawmakers frequently rely on their staffers to relay to them constituent views. And we'll talk more about that in a bit. There in the middle, among the communications that legislators and their staffers receive, it's personal messages that are the most persuasive. Now, as you can imagine, with technological innovations, the volume of constituent communications has grown enormously, whether that's phone calls, email, website comments, or social media posts. And amid that huge uptick in communications, you do see a rise in form letters, but it's really the personalized communications that are the most compelling, those individual stories, that unique perspective that can shed light on an issue. And what's more, as shown on the right-hand side, if a member or senator hasn't yet arrived at a firm decision on an issue, communications from constituents, and most importantly, in-person issue visits from constituents, are most likely to have an impact. At 46%, nearly half of staffers note that it's this type of engagement having the most positive impact on a lawmaker's policy decision. Now, that all being said, we should recognize that our efforts can take time to bear fruit. Efforts that seem to be struggling may suddenly gain traction, and those that seem like they're progressing at a fast clip may suddenly stall. Here we've listed a number of laws, along with the time that elapsed since the most recent comprehensive law had been enacted. And there are a number of factors that can impact the time frame, but the main takeaway is that advocacy success does take time. Now, this graphic doesn't yet reflect the comprehensive tax reform that was enacted in late 2017. So the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act of 2017 represented the most significant change to the tax code since the 1986 Tax Reform Act. So you can appreciate the point. Between 1986 and 2017, again, another 3 decades before major legislation passed. So again, the takeaway, we need to set our expectations for how quickly we may see change. And of course, sometimes an advocate's goal is not to pass legislation, but to prevent it from becoming law. Here, another look at this issue. On this page, we share with you the number of bills introduced into Congress between the 108th and the current 115th Congress. Our current session runs until the beginning of January 2019. And as you can see, in any given session, thousands of bills are introduced. Of those that are introduced, few are voted on, fewer still passed as resolution or enacted into law. So for example, if we look at the 114th Congress, which ended in January 2017, the vast majority of bills introduced, 97%, failed to become law, and most never even came close. Now, this may look daunting, but there are 2 takeaways from this slide. First, given that a small percentage of bills will get a vote in Congress and fewer still become law, we all as advocates will need to be resilient and patient in our work. Second, it is still important for your voice to be heard, because even those bills that don't pass can be important. Those bills can still spur dialogue among the public and serve to motivate current and future advocacy efforts. So it's through these discussions that advocates can inject a new perspective on an issue, a nuance that leads to constructive dialogue, even though the concrete policy outcomes stemming from that activity may not be immediately evident. Okay, now that we've gotten some context for your important role in the policymaking process, in the next section, we'll look at the types of individuals that you'll be connecting with here in Washington. Who is this audience that you'll be meeting with? The first piece to keep in mind is that congressional staffers significantly outnumber members of Congress. On the left-hand side here, we've got the House. In 2014, there were 435 members in the House of Representatives, compared to nearly 9,000 House staffers. And then on the right-hand side, the Senate, of course, has 100 senators. And in 2014, there were over 5,700 Senate staffers. So in total, between both chambers, we have just 535 lawmakers that we are trying to influence. And of course, ELFA advocates aren't the only ones that are trying to reach these lawmakers. These legislators have just so many hours in the day, and many stakeholders to whom they're held accountable, so their work is supported by thousands of congressional staffers. Now, these congressional staffers would reflect both personal office staff or committee staff. Now, personal office staff are those folks that are hired by one member of Congress and just responsible to that one member. So they're more likely to be from the district or the state that that member comes from. And the average House member has about 14 staffers working for them, compared to the average senator who has about, or the senator who has about 30. Now, committee staff are hired by the chairman or the ranking member of a particular committee, and they work for all those members that are present on that committee. So they're less likely to be from the district or the state of the chairman or ranking member, and they tend to be issue experts. House committees average around 68 congressional staffers, and Senate committees average around 46. Okay. Now, given the volume of stakeholders and the number of meetings happening on Capitol Hill, fly-in advocates should expect to speak with congressional staffers in their meetings. So here we've got a sample organizational structure for a congressional office. Here we're thinking now of the personal office staff for a particular member of Congress. So up at the top, you have the lawmaker that everyone reports up into. And then just below the lawmaker, their chief of staff, who serves as sort of their second in command. He or she will supervise the work in the office, and often they're the primary political advisor to the member with knowledge of what's going on in DC, in the district, in the broad portfolio of issues that the member works on. Below the chief of staff, starting from the left-hand side, you'll see that their staffers are generally split out by those that are first more policy-focused. Now, this would include folks with titles like legislative director, legislative assistant, counsel, or senior counsel. These are people that are focused on analyzing, drafting, and interpreting policy. Next, you'll have folks that are more communications focused. This includes communications directors, press secretaries. These are folks that are communicating the lawmaker's message to the media, whether national or local. And you've also got legislative correspondents who are responsible for the constituent communications for that office. And then moving over to the right again, you've got staff who deal with office operations. And then all the way to the right, you have district staff. These are the folks that you may engage with back home. Okay, now here we've got profiles of some of the folks occupying the roles that you might be encountering here in Washington. And these are folks that are more oriented to policy-specific issues in a member's personal office. Now, as mentioned, members of Congress are tremendously busy, and they're often double-booked for meetings. So you shouldn't be surprised if a member shows up or leaves partway through a meeting that you've scheduled with their office. Looking at the next three roles, meetings are most often scheduled with and run through one or more of these individuals. Again, you've got the chief of staff who serves as the member's right-hand man or woman, and she or he may be empowered to speak for the member. Then you've got legislative directors or legislative assistants who tend to specialize in specific policy areas. And then at the bottom, we have legislative correspondents or staff assistants who may attend your meeting as a junior staffer or as a note taker. Now, given the unpredictable nature of Capitol Hill, there is a possibility that you'll end up meeting with a more junior staffer. That said, while our Hill staffers tend to reflect younger generations, despite that youth, they can have enormous responsibility and do enjoy a lot of credibility with the lawmaker that they work for. And it's also good to keep in mind that roles can shift relatively quickly on the Hill. So today's legislative assistant could be tomorrow's chief of staff. And establishing those relationships today can be fruitful tomorrow. Okay, let me pause here and see if folks have any questions about those first two sections that we covered. Okay, great. So in this next section, we'll review the legislative process. Now, in one of the prior sections, we illustrated how bills can take a long time to pass and will need continual pressure on the part of advocates. Here, we'll remind you of that, all of that process, and help illustrate how bills can be stopped along the way to passage. Okay, so here we're looking at how a bill becomes a law. At the top, you have a lawmaker in the House or the Senate, and he or she gets the process started by introducing a bill. And you'll see the note there on the top left, legislation can be introduced in either chamber except for tax law, which must start in the House of Representatives. Next, that bill goes to the relevant committee or subcommittee that has jurisdiction over that area of law or policy. And there the bill is debated and amended. And then if a majority of the group agrees, it makes its way to the House or Senate floor. Now there again, the bill is debated and amended. And then in order to move on in the House of Representatives, the Speaker must allow a floor vote. And in the Senate, a 3/5 majority is needed to end debate. Now, once we get to the point of taking a vote, a simple majority is needed to pass the bill along to the next stage. Now, if an identical bill is passed in both chambers, the bill goes directly to the president. But if there are differences, the bill goes into conference committee to reconcile those differences. And most major bills do go to conference committee. And then the combined bill goes to the president. The president can then sign or veto the bill, and Congress can override a veto by passing the bill in each chamber with a 2/3 majority. Okay, so again, that's how a bill becomes a law. But I think another question that we might have is, how does a bill not become a law? Okay, so here's an outline of how a bill does not become a law, the different obstacles that a bill might face on its way to passage. In this example, we have a hypothetical bill making its way through the Senate, but a House bill could face similar challenges. You'll see at each stage of the process, there is an opportunity for efforts to fail. If it stalls in the committee phase, for example, those are shown up at the top. Or if it fails a vote or cloture motion, or if different procedural actions, like filibustering, shown there at the bottom, prevent the bill from passing. So all those boxes in red highlight a number of potential fail points along the way to passage of this bill. Now, this may look like bad news or good news, depending on whether you support or oppose the bill in question. But even if the bill makes it through this process, there are additional steps to consider. Even after passage by both the House and Senate, the bill may still face challenges. That is, even if the bill passes both the House and the Senate, the president can prevent it from being enacted by using the power of the veto, which Congress can override with a 2/3 vote in both the House and the Senate. And there are a couple other outcomes that are possible. Now you look over there to the right-hand side. On the upper right-hand side, even if a bill is enacted, legal challenges can also be mounted to prevent enforcement of the law. And then looking at the lower right-hand side, even if the bill is enacted, the president could prevent it from being enforced through the use of executive orders or signing statements. Okay, now just a couple more slides on legislative process. Here, a note on the Congressional Review Act. Now, this is an oversight tool introduced in 1996, and this statute empowers Congress to overturn rules that are issued by a federal agency. So after a rule is published, under this procedure, Congress can review new federal regulations before they take effect. And if Congress disapproves the new rule through a special joint resolution, and if that's signed by the president, the rules will have no force or effect. Essentially, those regulations are nullified. Now, what's special about this rule is that the House and Senate can nullify regulations with a simple majority vote in both chambers. Now, I bring up the CRA because we've seen it used with greater frequency with the current administration to overturn a variety of rules from the prior administration. Now, here are some important details around the CRA, which you can take away and read more carefully, but let me just highlight a few things. First, there is a 60-day consideration period. So all rules need to be reported to Congress, and then after getting a report, Congress has 60 legislative working days to introduce a special joint resolution to disapprove the rule. Now, CRA also only applies to major rules, which are defined as those having a major economic impact, for example, in terms of its dollar value to the economy or the cost that it incurs to different stakeholders. Now, CRA also says that if Congress disapproves the rule, it not only nullifies the regulation, but it also prohibits the federal agency from reissuing the same regulation or one that's substantially similar unless it meets certain criteria. Now, before 2017, current administration, the CRA had only been successfully used once. And since 2017, with the current administration and the Republican control of Congress, we've seen 15 disapproval resolutions come to pass. Okay. Now, in this next section, we'll cover the steps that you can take before, during, and after your Hill meeting to set yourself up for success, how you can prepare for your conversations, what you should think about as we conduct these meetings, and how you can follow up once you've left Washington. Okay, so what might you think about prior to your face-to-face meeting? Now, your stories are powerful tools for policy, and you can have a huge impact through your flying visits that the LFA has arranged. And as we've established, members do want to hear from you. Now, you've gotten a packet, or you will get a packet, of issues and talking points on the issues that you will want to communicate. But recognizing that time is at a premium, we can talk about the ways that we can prepare to ensure that we're as persuasive as possible in our meeting. So here we've highlighted five key elements that you'll want to consider in conveying your story or your experience. And then at the bottom, you see a sample articulation of each of these five elements. First, you'll want to reinforce your geographic tie to the office. This helps establish your relevance to the lawmaker that you're meeting with. Next, you'll want to make reference to the member or senator's connection to your issue, what it is that you came to them to speak about. Third, if there is an element of urgency, why that issue matters now, you want to make sure that you highlight that too. Then you'll share your experience, explain how the member or senator could express their support for your position, and offer additional information if it's available. And then finally, if there's any upcoming outreach, make note of that, or if it's appropriate, invite the member back to home discussion back home or to an event. And remember, what you're trying to do is to persuade and position yourself as a resource. So the goal here is to connect your story or your experience to the issues, the priorities, and the activities that the lawmaker is engaged on. You want to help them understand why your views are relevant and how your experience adds to their perspective or their understanding of an issue. Now, when making policy decisions, members of Congress primarily want constituents to answer four questions. First, what actions do these constituents want me to take? Second, why do constituents want me to do that? Third, what are the current and potential or local impacts of this policy? And then finally, what are constituents' personal stories or connections to that policy? So, as you prep for your meeting, it'll be helpful to think through these elements. And you might also consider how you might modify your message if a meeting is cut short or runs long. That is, what would you say in your two-minute elevator pitch? Or if you had 15 minutes to share your perspective, how could you describe the actions that you're seeking, why you're seeking that, what the local impact might be, and what your experience is? Okay, now that we've prepped for these conversations, what should we keep in mind when we're conducting these face-to-face meetings? What are we doing in the moment? Again, we've got five tips to support you here. First of all, be on time, but no more than 5 minutes before the meeting, Because not only is time at a premium, but space is too. So if you come too early, it might be difficult for the office to accommodate folks physically. Of course, if you are going to be late, please do let the office know that in case another time needs to be arranged for your meeting, because as we mentioned, schedules are tightly managed. Next, be flexible. Recognize that you may meet with a member or senator or a congressional staff member who would serve as a proxy for the lawmaker that they work for. Now, as I mentioned, a member might arrive partway through the meeting, and if that's the case, don't feel obligated to restart the conversation. The lawmaker will ask questions if necessary, and the staffers will always be there to fill in the gap. Third, just focus on the topic that's on the agenda rather than introduce new issues. Next, remember to keep politics out of the discussion. Do not make reference to elections or campaign support. And then finally, if you do have leave behinds, make sure that these are short, 1 to 2 page documents that summarize your main points. Now again, these tips are designed to help you position yourself as a helpful resource to the office. Okay, now one of the challenges that organizations often face is that momentum around an issue often slips after a big push. So ideally, we'd be able to maintain momentum and keep activity and pressure up after our visit. But more often than not, we'll drop down to our pre-visit engagement level. So how can we continue to build on the work here in Washington? Well, one element is recognizing that the fly-in meeting is just a single step in an active relationship building process. So how do we keep that momentum up? Well, one way to do this is to use our meeting follow-up to build trust with the lawmaker's office and continue to serve as a resource for them. Here, a few concrete things that you can do. First, send a thank you note, keep it short, remind them what you spoke about, and again, include links to relevant research if it's appropriate. Next, attend in-district events. Now, remember, members of Congress have staffers here in DC, but they also have staff back home. So you can attend public events or town halls where your representative is present, and also try to serve as a resource for their district staff. Finally, stay in touch, but don't over-communicate. Staffers receive hundreds of emails a day, so it's difficult for many of them to keep on top of their inboxes. But if you can provide new information that's relevant to your issue and will be helpful for the lawmaker's decision-making or thought process, you might consider sharing that. The key, again, is to engage in a way so that you position yourself as a trustworthy and valued advocate for your issue. Okay, let me pause here again, see if folks have any questions before we head into the last section here. Okay. Well, let's close this out by going over some of the logistics around your visit to the nation's capital. First, the Hill is a relatively small neighborhood, but it's good to keep in mind how you'll be getting around. If you are coming by car, you should recognize that there are a few public parking options and street parking is difficult, so you might consider ride sharing, Uber or Lyft are popular here, as alternatives to driving yourself. If you do opt to drive, you'll want to factor in the time to find parking into your planning process. Most folks will opt for public transportation, whether by metro, which is the local term for the subway, or metro bus. And the different subway lines are color-coded. There are three primary stations surrounding the Hill. They're on the red, blue, orange, or silver lines. And then finally, even if you take a car or public transportation, you'll still be doing a fair amount of walking, so you'll want to wear comfortable shoes. Now, the summer months are particularly hot and humid, and though you should have good weather in May, although today it's getting in the 80s, you'll want to plan ahead to ensure that you can get around comfortably. Now, on that note, we recommend business or business casual attire rather than jeans for Hill visits, so that's just another factor to keep in mind in trying to keep comfortable as you make your way around DC. Here, we have a layout of the House and Senate office building. You'll see the House is on one side of the Capitol building and the Senate on the other side. Now, the key buildings on the House side are Rayburn, Longworth, and Cannon. And then on the Senate side, the key buildings are Russell, Dirksen, and Hart. Now, again, looking at this map of Capitol Hill, it doesn't look very large, but these are long blocks and large buildings, so do expect to do a fair amount of walking. Okay, now this page is for your reference. It shows the addresses for those key buildings that we highlighted on the prior page. Again, we've got Rayburn, Longworth, and Cannon on the House side, Russell, Dirksen, and Hart on the Senate side. And the address themselves are follow a formula, as we'll see in the next couple pages. And I know some folks will be kind of going around on their own, so it's helpful, I think, to understand how to decipher some of these room numbers. Okay, so here we've zoomed in on the House side of the map. Again, you see the three primary buildings, Rayburn, Longworth, and Cannon. We've got icons on the map for the public handicap accessible building entrances. And then in the table, we have the abbreviations for the offices, along with an explanation of how to decipher the numbering system and examples in that last row of the table. So within Rayburn, as an example, the rooms are four digits long, and the first number is always 2. The second number indicates a 4. So you'll see in that example, Congressman Steve Cohen, there at the bottom, represents the 9th District in Tennessee. His office number is 2404. The first digit is a 2, which indicates it's in Rayburn. And the second digit is a 4, meaning he is on the fourth floor. Okay, now here we've got a schematic of where the different rooms would be located within the three House office buildings. So again, if we were looking for Representative Cohen, remember he's in 2404 Rayburn, we'd look for his office there in the Rayburn building, and at 2404, he's there on the fourth floor on the Independence Avenue side of the building. Okay, now for the Senate side, again, we've zoomed here on the map. You see the three primary buildings, Russell, Dirksen, and Hart. Again, icons on the map for the building entrances, public handicap accessible building entrances. And then in the table, we've got abbreviations for the offices, along with the explanation for how to decipher the numbering system, and again, an example at the bottom. So the Senate rooms are all three digits long, where the first digit reflects the 4. So in looking at the example here, Senator Schumer's office is in the Hart building. Office number 322 indicates that it is on the third floor. And again, the floor plan, this time for the Senate office building, with an indication, again, where the different rooms would be within those buildings. So if we were looking for Senator Schumer, again, 322 Hart, we'd look first in the Hart building. He's on the third floor since the room number begins with a 3. And he's in that corridor that runs parallel to First Street, closer to the C Street side of the Hart building.
Okay,
so that brings me to the end of what we have prepared for you today. If I could just recap, we talked about the really important and unique role that you'll be playing in advocacy through your fly-in visits arranged by ELFA. We covered the types of individuals that you'll be likely meeting with here on Capitol Hill, giving you a sense for their role. We talked a little bit about the legislative process. We also talked about what you might do before, during, and after your meeting to have the most impact. And then finally, we closed some very tactical information to help you plan your day. I hope that you found this useful, valuable information. Grateful to ELFA for the opportunity to share this with you, and would be delighted to answer any questions.
Okay, everyone. This is Chelsea Neal from ELFA. I don't see any questions. So if you have any questions, feel free to shoot me an email. This recording will be uploaded to the Capital Connections website, and the slide deck will be available to print. So I hope you guys have a great rest of your day, and thank you so much to Gina and Jackie for being here to present. All right, thanks everyone.